So this is the first lecture I was to give for the graduate students in the Fields seminar, Fields Institute seminar. This is supposed to be followed up by a lecture on the 27th, which is more of a seminar style. So I guess this is more like an introduction to get the people warmed up and decide whether they want to attend the second lecture or not. And it's challenging. I'm not a professional in these video lectures, but I'm going to send the notes over and the people should have the notes. So you're welcome to be asking questions in the next lecture after having gone through the notes. And we can spend some time discussing that before we start the next lecture on the 27th. Okay, thanks to the Fields Institute for this invitation to give this virtual series of lectures. And the broad title of my lecture series is going to be Selmer Groups in Arithmetic. And today's lecture, and also it's going to overlap with part of the second lecture, since I don't think I can get to what I wanted to do in this one. The idea is to discuss the various Selmer groups and some other definitions that are necessary to study these Selmer groups. And I'm going to divide this into four sections: definitions, invariants, results and conjectures, and then go to connections to arithmetic and algebra. So I'm hoping to get up to section 3 in today's lecture, and the beginning of the next lecture, I will start with some of the problems and also go over to discuss some of the results that have been proved recently. So the Selmer groups, of course, people know Selmer groups in the context of Selmer groups arising from elliptic curves. And that's because that's the only way you can study the rational points of elliptic curves, which of course is an object of great arithmetic interest. But what is true is that Selmer groups need not be restricted just to elliptic curves. You can frame the definition of Selmer groups for a broader class, namely Selmer groups arising from Galois representations. And the Galois representations arising from elliptic curves, when you focus on that specific case, you end up with the usual classical Selmer groups of elliptic curves as is classical. Okay, so here is the background. F is going to be a number field, so which means that it's a finite extension of the field of rational numbers. And P is an odd prime. And we'll always fix a finite set of primes, which I'm going to call S. And S, this finite set, always has to contain the primes of F lying above the fixed prime P, the fixed odd prime P. We will later add more elements to this set S, but at the least minimum, it has to contain the primes of the number field lying above P, and we'll enlarge it later when we study the different Selmer groups arising from the Galois representations. And as always, F subscript S, FS, denotes the maximal extension of F, which is unramified outside of S. And we will work with extensions L such that F is contained in L, this is script L, and L is contained in FS, this maximal unramified extension outside S. And for us, L will in general be infinite extensions, infinite Galois extensions. And so the right way to think about these infinite Galois extensions is to think of them as a direct limit of finite Galois extensions. So I'll think of L as being a union of Ln's, where the union is taken over the various n, n greater than or equal to zero. And these Ln's are finite Galois extensions of the base field F. So L will typically be an infinite Galois extension of F, which is contained in Fs. So let L over F be such an extension, and let's call the Galois group L over F script G. And whenever you have an infinite extension like this, so this Galois group G is a profinite group, and we define the Iwasawa algebra. That's going to be one of the algebraic objects that's very important. And so let me define it. I'm going to denote it by lambda of G, where G is the profinite group. Lambda of G is just the inverse limit of Zp G mod Gn, where the Gn's vary over open normal subgroups of G. So typically, I mentioned that this L is going to be a union of finite extensions Ln. So we could take Gn to be the corresponding open normal subgroup of the Galois group of L over F. So G mod Gn is going to be a group, and Zp G mod Gn is the usual group ring. And then there are these natural surjections from g mod gn plus 1 to g mod gn and so on. And then you take the inverse limit of those, and that defines the Iwasawa algebra. And this inverse limit, as I mentioned, is taken with respect to the natural surjective maps. Now, why does one do this? Why does one take the Iwasawa algebra rather than just working with the group rings themselves? That's because doing algebra over group rings is very difficult. And one has absolutely no idea of how to study modules over group rings. An arbitrary group, and you take the group ring of such a group, it's a whole research area by itself to understand the group rings and to understand the interesting objects there, to study modules over group rings and so on. Whereas when we take the inverse algebra, Iwasawa algebra, that is when we take this inverse limit, then you're in some sense taking the completion. And then that becomes a much nicer algebraic object to study, as we will see below. And in particular, modules, the study of modules over these completed group algebras, that is these Iwasawa algebras, they have a richer structure. And that's the main reason. So you go to an infinite extension, but you still have the Galois group. You're going up a tower and you have these Galois groups. So you can play with Galois cohomology to descend, to come down. So that's the basic idea, one of the key ideas in Iwasawa theory. So now here are some facts about the Iwasawa algebra, which again will be very useful. So there are two kinds of Iwasawa algebras. When this Galois group G is abelian, then the corresponding algebra that you get is going to be a commutative algebra, commutative Noetherian algebra. And if it is not commutative, if the group G is not abelian, then you get a non-commutative Iwasawa algebra. But still, it has some nice structures, and I'm going to collect those facts. So for instance, if this Galois group G is a pro-P periodic analytic group such that it has no elements of order P, then the Iwasawa algebra lambda G is both a left and right Noetherian local domain. So domain is the usual domain. It has no zero divisors. It only has non-zero divisors. And then local is its local. As a non-commutative ring, it's local. There's a unique maximal ideal, two-sided maximal ideal. And then there's a concept of left Noetherian, right Noetherian. So it's left and right Noetherian. So many of the properties that we know in commutative algebra sort of cross over in this non-commutative setting as well. And then assume that G is as in one. So from now on, I'll be assuming that the profinite group that I'm working with is a pro-P. What do we mean by pro-P? It's an inverse limit of P groups. And it's periodic analytic group. So periodic analytic, think of Q. We know that Q has all these metrics, one coming from the absolute value and the others corresponding to the primes P, and you can complete Q with respect to any of these metrics. So of course, when we complete with respect to the usual absolute value, you get the real numbers, and otherwise you get QP. Now, just as we study real manifolds and complex manifolds, you can also study the manifolds where the metric is somehow coming from this periodic metric. So that gives rise to what's called a periodic analytic manifold. And any periodic analytic manifold with the group structure is a periodic analytic group. So typically a neighborhood of a point here, which will look like ZP. Whereas in the case of a real manifold, it will look like an open disk in the real line. Or in the complex manifold, it will look like an open disk in the complex plane. Whereas for a periodic analytic manifold, the typical neighborhood looks like a ZP. And so this Iwasawa algebra has a left and right Noetherian local domain structure. And then moreover, it has another very interesting property, which is what makes this whole study interesting and gives you the flexibility to work with non-abelian Galois extensions. So this ring lambda of G, this algebra lambda of G, this is a ZP algebra. It in fact behaves, for all practical purposes, it behaves like a regular local ring in a non-commutative context. So this Iwasawa algebra lambda of G, when G is even non-abelian, still has a very interesting structure as a non-commutative algebra. It's a domain, it's local, and it's what's called Auslander regular. Now, Auslander regular is the best approximation you can have to being a regular local ring in a non-commutative setting. And if your ring is actually commutative, then it coincides with the usual regular local rings that we know in commutative algebra. So the best way to think about this is that it is a non-commutative generalization of the concept of regular local rings. But more interesting for us will be the fact that once it's an Auslander regular domain, it affords a dimension theory. Just like for the case of commutative algebras, we have dimension theory, Krull dimension, coming from the height of maximal ideals, length of chains of maximal ideals, and so on. In the non-commutative setting, it's not so straightforward, because even defining prime ideals, when they are two-sided and so on, that's all very challenging. And so this dimension theory works through homological algebra. In fact, if you go back to the classical setting in the context of commutative algebras, you can see that the dimension can also be interpreted, the Krull dimension can also be interpreted purely in terms of homological algebraic terms. And that homological algebra part sort of crosses over even in a non-commutative context. But I will just be content with saying that because it's an Auslander regular domain, there is a dimension theory which is available for modules over lambda of G, for all finitely generated modules over the Ivasava algebra. And as I mentioned, so this Ivasava algebra is non-commutative if G is not abelian. And if G is abelian, then lambda of G coincides with the commutative local regular ring as we know in commutative algebra. And there's one other very useful fact that we will be using. So part of Ivasava algebra involves Galois cohomology. You're going to be studying because you're going up and down the tower. So to descend, you're going to be using Galois cohomology. And this is where this fact will be useful. So this Galois group G, which is a periodic analytic group, and I mentioned that you can think of it as a periodic analytic manifold. So take any point, take a neighborhood, it looks like certain copies of ZP. The number of copies of ZP, that's called the dimension of G as a periodic analytic group. And so it has a dimension as a periodic analytic group, and turns out that this dimension is also the P cohomological dimension of this G considered as a Galois group. So when you want to do Galois cohomology, you have a hold on the cohomological dimension of this group G. It is nothing but the dimension of G considered as a periodic analytic group. So for example, when we take G to be just ZP, I'll be discussing some more examples further down. So for instance, when we take G to be ZP, so if there's just one copy of ZP, so any neighborhood can look at most like ZP. So the dimension is one. And if you take ZP to the power D, then of course the dimension is going to be D. Okay, now we are gradually moving towards defining the Selmer groups and fine Selmer groups. And I'll mainly consider the Galois representations associated to elliptic curves. But there's an analogous theory for a broader class of Galois representations, such as those coming from modular forms or abelian varieties, or in fact, any Galois representation, any representation of the Galois group of Q or of the number field into a vector space, typically into a QP vector space, will give us corresponding Selmer groups and so on. But we will largely discuss elliptic curves, and it's very clear how to generalize these to abelian varieties from elliptic curves. For the case of modular forms, that's a little more challenging. So you have to first understand what's happening in the case of elliptic curves, then think of elliptic curves as representations coming from weight 2 modular forms, and then try to understand what happens for other weight 2 modular forms over not necessarily Q, and then move over to modular forms of higher weight. But for now, let's stick to elliptic curves. So we start with E over F, an elliptic curve. This has good reduction at all the primes above P. So if V is a place of F lying above P, we have the base change EV, which is just the elliptic curve E, scalars extended to the completion FV, obtained by base change. Now, what does it mean to say good reduction? So good reduction just means that we have the J invariant of E of the original elliptic curve, and the valuation of that J invariant with respect to the place V is greater than or equal to zero. So good reduction further gives two possibilities. So first of all, take an elliptic curve over F, then take a prime V lying above P, then look at the J invariant, and that if it has integral J invariant with respect to the valuation V, then it has good reduction. And then within good reduction, there are two cases. One is called good ordinary reduction, and the other is called good supersingular reduction. So good ordinary reduction is the following. So good reduction broadly means that when I base change to the local field FV, and then I can look at the reduced curve. So you typically base change, you can think of a minimal Weierstrass equation, and you can even think of this elliptic curve as being defined over the ring of integers in FV. So which allows us to reduce modulo the maximal ideal. So we really get a reduced curve over the residue field KV. Good reduction means, first of all, that this reduced curve as a curve over the finite field is non-singular. And then within that, ordinary reduction means that the P torsion points, or P primary torsion points, the P to the power R torsion points of the reduced curve for any R greater than or equal to 1 is one copy of Z mod P to the power RZ. So that's the case of ordinary reduction. And supersingular reduction means that it has no P to the power R torsion points. The reduced curve has no P to the power R torsion points for any R greater than or equal to 1. So for those of you who know a little about the elliptic curves over local fields, the good ordinary reduction case, what happens is that the representation really splits into two parts, one coming from the formal group and then another coming from the reduced curve. Ordinary reduction, this splitting is equal. So there's one half of it coming from the formal group and another from the reduced curve. And in the supersingular case, it completely comes only from the formal group. There is no contribution from the reduced curve. So it depends. If you want to think of it algebraically, you think of it in terms of the model and then the contributions of the formal group part and the closed fiber part and so on. But again, this you can make analogous definitions for Galois representations coming from modular forms or from abelian varieties. For abelian varieties, it's clear again what happens. So you take an abelian variety of dimension G, then the associated Galois representation is a 2G dimensional vector space. And ordinary means that of this 2G components, one half, that is 1G, comes from the formal group, and what G, the other part G, comes from the reduced abelian variety. Supersingular means, again, not the whole contribution. Somehow you then have to talk about the height of the formal group and so on. Things get a little more technical, but there are these corresponding definitions even for the Galois representations coming from abelian varieties. Similarly, for the Galois representations coming from modular forms, where there the level of the modular form will play a role. We'll talk about that later. Towards the end of the lecture, I say a few things about the corresponding notions for modular forms. Okay, so now let's come down to defining the Selmer groups. So this is my general setting. I start with a number field F. I have a script L, which is an infinite extension, which is contained in this maximal unramified extension outside S. Remember, this S was always a finite set, which contained the primes above P in F. But now when we are working with elliptic curves, we will enlarge this set S to contain also the primes where the elliptic curve has bad reduction. So S will typically be a finite set, but it has to contain the set of primes above P and also the set of primes for bad reduction of the elliptic curve. And we will vary over finite intermediary extensions of F, which are contained in this script L. So the idea is to think of the script L as a union of finite extensions Ln, where Ln are sub-extensions of L and are finite over F. So I'm going to define the Selmer group. The P, prime P, is always fixed. So this is really the P Selmer group. But I'm not going to keep saying P because I've fixed a P and all my definitions will be with respect to this fixed prime P. So cell P infinity E over F, or just a shortened notation, because P is fixed, I'll just denote it by cell E over F. So we first define it at two levels. First, we define the P to the N Selmer group, and then take limits over P to the N. And then we define it at the finite level. So you take a finite extension L of F. So define the Selmer groups at the finite level. And then if you want to define it over infinite extensions, you take the direct limit as the finite extensions vary. Think of the infinite extensions as being a direct limit of these finite extensions, and then you define the Selmer group over this infinite extension to be the direct limit of the Selmer groups defined over the finite extensions. So Selmer Pn of E over L, the P to the power n Selmer group of E over a finite extension L is defined to be the kernel of this Galois group Fs over L, the Galois group of Fs over L with EPn coefficients. EPn are the P to the power n torsion points of the elliptic curve over the algebraic closure. So I should really be writing EPn of F bar, but EPn, I just think of it as a Galois module. So it's implicit that this is the F bar rational points, P to the power n torsion points of E over F bar. And of course, there's the Galois group acting on it. Fs over L act, the Galois group Fs over L acts on it. And we take the first Galois cohomology and then take its natural map to JVs, which I'm going to describe here. So JV of E over L is just H1 of FW E, where this direct sum is taken over all the W, the primes W lying over my fixed V. V is a prime of F, but when I go to L, there'll be a bunch of valuations extending V. So these W's are those valuations which extend W, and then H1 FW, these decomposition groups. There's a natural map. This sits inside the absolute Galois group of the number field. So there's a natural restriction map. But here, note one difference. I'm changing the coefficients. For the global case, the coefficient was P to the power n torsion points of E. Whereas here, I'm taking all the points of E. So this is really H1 FW E of FV bar, if you like. And now this one, since I'm taking the direct sum over all the valuations that lie over the fixed V, the Galois group, the decomposition group acts on this, right? There's a Galois group action. In fact, the Galois group of the number field acts on this direct sum. And this will be my general notation for any module M. When I put M of P to the N, that will denote the P to the power N torsion subgroup of M. And so here EPN is really the P to the power n torsion subgroup of E of F bar and so on. So when I don't put a field, that means that I'm taking the points over the algebraic closure of the base field. So then the Selmer group, in fact, fits into this exact sequence. So Selmer PN E over L goes to H1 FS over L EPN and then goes to these direct sum of these local terms, JV of E over L PN. And this is very important. So here, JV of L, the coefficients are different. And the EPN in the global Galois group, global H1, when I'm considering the local terms, I'm not considering EPN. I'm just taking the whole elliptic curve. So then that kernel is defined to be the P to the power N Selmer group. And then we take direct limits over EPN. Then we get the infinite Selmer group. Sel P infinity of E over L goes to H1 FS over L EP infinity goes to JV E over L. And of course, because this is P to the N torsion, it lands inside the P to the N torsion of JV. So when we take direct limits, it lands into the primary torsion of the local terms. Now, because this infinite Galois group is a direct limit of all the finite extensions, LN inside the infinite extension, so we can now take the direct limits with respect to the natural inclusion maps of L inside LN, LN inside the script L. So we get the Selmer group defined over this infinite extension, Sel P infinity E over L going to H1 FS over L EP infinity. And this map is again going to play an important role later. So I'll give it a name. Let's call this lambda L. That is the global to local map which defines the Selmer group. So whenever I talk of lambda of a field, lambda of L, this means that I'm taking the defining map for the Selmer group. So we have an exact sequence like this. Let me denote it by star. And then to simplify notation, I'm just going to write JV of E over L. I'll suppress the P primary torsion, but remember it's really landing inside the P infinity torsion of these groups. Now this exact sequence, if we go back to the tower, so we have taken the Galois group from FS over L. We have taken Galois cohomology from FS over L. So you still have the residual action. You have the action of L over F, because this whole thing is a Galois extension. Fs over F is a Galois extension. And we have taken Galois cohomology from Fs down to script L. So the remaining quotient, that is the Galois group of L over F, acts on these Galois cohomology groups. So that means, translating that into this context, when we take this defining sequence for the Selma group, each of these terms has the action of the Galois group of script L over F. And this is in fact an exact sequence of Galois modules. So this exact sequence star is an exact sequence of Galois L over F modules. And then further, there's another way to think of the Selma group. The Selma group fits into this exact sequence. So I have an extension L inside F of S, E of L tensored with QP mod ZP sitting inside. So this is called the model way part of the Selma group. And then the second term, this is the Selma group that we defined above. And this last term, this is the Tate-Shafravitch group, SHA of E over L, the P primary part of the Tate-Shafravitch group. And what is the Tate-Shafravitch group? The Tate-Shafravitch group of E over L for a finite extension is just defined to be the kernel from H1LE, the Galois group of L bar over L, E, to H1LVE. So L is the global object, LV is the completions over all the places of L. And then this is induced by the usual restriction map because these are decomposition groups. So there's a natural restriction map. So this is the honest H1LE. I'm not doing anything funny here. The coefficients are the same. It is E and E. Whereas for the Selma group, we did something funny. We put EP inside. And here for the local terms, we let it be L. So these were the local terms even for the Selma. But here, the global term was not E, but it was EP infinity. So that gets compensated for by the model way group. So we get an exact sequence like this. So a good reference for all this is Silverman's book, The Elliptic Arithmetic of Elliptic Curves, is a good definition if people want to read up more. And in particular, you see one of the important changes we have made is that the Tate-Shafravitch group, you need to take the local terms to vary over all the primes. Whereas when we define the Selma group, we only have to take it over a finite set of primes, namely the primes in S, which include the primes above P and the primes of bad reduction. So to understand why this is possible, why you can work with this smaller direct sum, that's nicely explained because you don't need to worry about the primes where it has good reduction. It automatically, this map automatically goes to zero when you define the Selma group. So that's why you can afford to only look at this finite sum end here. Okay, so next let's discuss the kind of extensions we are going to be looking at. So mainly three kinds of infinite extensions. That's where the theory is sort of well matured and we have some interesting results and the subject has progressed to a considerable extent. So the first is when L is the cyclotomic ZP extension. So that means F cyclotomic is contained in the extension of F obtained by attaching all the P roots of unity. Mu P infinity denotes a set of all P power roots of unity. And F of mu P infinity over F, this is a Galois extension with Galois group ZP star, the units in the ring of periodic integers. So in particular, it looks like ZP cross Z mod P minus 1. So the ring of periodic integers times Z mod P minus 1. So we are taking F cyclotomic, which is the ZP quotient inside F of mu P infinity. So that's the first example. That's how Iwasawa theory arose. Iwasawa first studied extensions of this kind, where the Galois group was isomorphic to ZP. In particular, this one, he also studied other ZP extensions. Then the next one is what's called false state curve extension. So here, note that the Galois group is simplest. It is abelian because it is ZP, and it is one-dimensional as a periodic analytic group. So the next case is K infinity. It's usually called the false state extension. So what you do in this case is you take the cyclotomic extension, the cyclotomic ZP extension, or more generally the extension obtained by attaching all the P roots of unity. Let's ignore the Z mod P minus one part. Let me assume that it contains mu P so that this is just ZP. Sorry, this should be F of mu P infinity. And then above that, I have this extension K infinity. So K infinity is got by looking at F cyclotomic and then attaching the P power roots of some periodic integer M, where M is assumed not to have any P power factors. So when you take the factorization of m, you can typically, even for simplicity, let's even assume that m is an integer. So in the prime factorization, there are no factors that arise to the power p. So that's the kind of m that you choose. So that's basically inspired by Kummer theory. So it's like taking Kummer extensions over the cyclotomic extension. So over the cyclotomic extension, and let me add 1 over p so that this looks like a ZP. Okay, so in other words, I can assume that my number field already contains the pth roots of unity. So that this is ZP, and then over that, I take the pth roots of some integer m and keep attaching pth roots, p squared roots, and so on, p infinity roots of m. So that gives me another ZP. So this is like a Kummer extension layer of Kummer extensions. So this whole Galois group contains two copies of ZP, but it is not a direct product. It's a semi-direct product. So in that sense, it's a non-trivial extension because you get a non-commutative Yerkes-Dodds algebra. So it is ZP, semi-direct product ZP. But it is simple in the sense that the Galois group, this is the next dimension. So we started with one-dimensional p-adic analytic manifold. Here, this is a two-dimensional p-adic analytic manifold. Of course, you can also take ZP cross ZP, and that arises very naturally in the series when we consider elliptic curves with complex multiplication. I'll talk about that a little later. But this is novel in the sense it is two copies of ZP, but it is not a direct product. So you get a non-commutative Yerkes-Dodds algebra. Then the third extension that we'll be considering is what I call F infinity. So again, let me assume, to sort of have pro P groups, I'm going to assume that my base field F contains the P torsion points of the elliptic curve E. So F contains EP, F of EP. So take the P torsion points, attach all the coordinates. I'm going to assume that the P torsion points of the elliptic curve are defined over the base field F. So then I can attach the P primary torsion coordinates of the elliptic curve. So for E of F bar, when I multiply by P to the N, I look at the kernel, that is EPN, and I attach the coordinates of those points. So that gives me Galois extensions of my base field. And I take the union of all those extensions and I get F of EP infinity. This is usually called the trivializing extension because, you know, this is the extension through which the Galois representation associated to the elliptic curve factors. And this F infinity is always contained in Fs. Once I demand that S contains the primes of Bad reduction for the elliptic curve and the primes above P, then it's well known that F infinity is contained in Fs. These are properties of the Galois representation associated to the elliptic curve. And further, from the theory of elliptic curves, one knows that F infinity contains the cyclotomic extension, the cyclotomic ZP extension. So F cyclotomic over F is ZP. F infinity over F cyclotomic is huge. So typically this Galois group G, which is the Galois group of F infinity over F, comes in two kinds. So one, either E has complex multiplication or it doesn't have complex multiplication. So let me assume that it does not have complex multiplication. So in that case, it's a deep result of Serre that this Galois group is huge and it's highly non-commutative. It's an open subgroup of GL2ZP. And when it has complex multiplication and I make some minor hypothesis, then what happens is this F infinity over F, when it has complex multiplication and I assume that F contains the field of complex multiplication as well as the P torsion points of the elliptic curve, this F infinity over F turns out to be just two copies, the direct product ZP cross ZP. Okay, so now let's define the Tate module TP of E. That's the Tate module of the elliptic curve. This is just the inverse limit of EPN, the P to the power N torsion points of the elliptic curve. So of course you should think of TPE as being two copies of ZP. So it's a free ZP module of rank 2, but comes with a Galois action, because this TP of E is really EPN of F bar. So there is the natural Galois action on TPE. And then we'll take the vector space coming from TPE, which I'm going to denote by V, and that is just TPE tensored with QP. So that is two copies of QP. It's a two-dimensional QP vector space. V is a two-dimensional QP vector space, but comes with the Galois action. So in other words, an elliptic curve E, when you fix a prime P, etc., then you get a natural Galois representation, which I denote by rho E from the Galois group F. GF is the absolute Galois group of F bar over F, from there into GL of V, where V is now this two-dimensional vector space over QP. And the image of this Galois representation turns out to be a quotient of this Galois group, right? Because it's the image under a, it's a continuous representation. Remember, everything has a topology here. QP has a topology, so V comes equipped with a topology, GLV comes equipped with a topology, GF is a Galois group, it has the profinite topology, and this in fact turns out to be a continuous representation. And the image of this Galois representation is going to be a quotient of this Galois group, of the absolute Galois group. And that is nothing but this Galois group of F of EP infinity over F. That's why it's called the trivializing extension. That's really the extension. So F infinity, the extension, the Galois group above F infinity acts trivially on this representation. So this Galois group really factors through this quotient F infinity over F. Okay, so in all these examples, this Galois group is a compact periodic analytic group. And so therefore we can talk of the associated Iwasawa algebra and examine it in more detail. So for instance, if G is abelian, the simplest case is a cyclotomic extension. So let's say G is isomorphic to gamma. I'm going to call it gamma when it is the cyclotomic ZP extension. So gamma is isomorphic to ZP. And in this case, the Iwasawa algebra turns out to be a regular local ring. It's a power series ring in one variable over ZP. So it's a two-dimensional regular local ring, ZP double brackets T. And similarly, for instance, when we take elliptic curves with complex multiplication, and in that case, G will be two copies of ZP. So then the Iwasawa algebra will be ZP T1 T2. Okay, so in all of these examples, the Selmer group is actually a discrete module. It again comes with a topology and it carries the discrete topology as a module over the Iwasawa algebra. The Iwasawa algebra is also a compact algebra. It comes equipped with the topology. And it's convenient to take the Pontryagin dual. So that's just the continuous homomorphism from Selmer group into QP mod ZP. So that's always the Pontryagin dual. So that's denoted by X of EL. This is a compact, finitely generated lambda G module. So it acquires more structure. It's compact and finitely generated. And finite generation is not difficult to see. And so now, remember this exact sequence that we had. And in the special case that L is a cyclotomic extension, I put G equals gamma, then we have all of these are now, in that case, modules over a regular local ring. And in this case, there is a very nice structure theorem for modules over these kind of regular local rings. This is, after all, a factorization, what's called a divisorial ring. This is almost a principal ideal domain, but it's not a principal ideal domain, but it's a quasi-principal ideal domain in the sense that it's a two-dimensional regular local ring and all height one prime ideals are principal. It's only the maximal ideal, which is generated by P and T. That's not principal. But every height one prime ideal is principal. And that's what plays a role in us being able to get a structure theorem. And this structure theorem is already known to Iwasawa. Iwasawa said it follows from commutative algebraic ideas. And more generally, suppose we have an abelian group G. Let's say it's D copies of ZP. Then the Iwasawa algebra is the power series ring in D variables over ZP. And any finitely generated module over such a commutative Iwasawa algebra is what's called pseudo-isomorphic to a module as below. So M is pseudo-isomorphic. This tilde means pseudo-isomorphic. I'll explain what it means. So M almost for all practical purposes looks like certain number of copies of the free module, that is lambda G to the power R. Then a direct sum of a bunch of lambda G modulo the prime ideal P to the certain power. So P is again a height one prime ideal. So lambda G mod P to the certain powers. And then Fj. Fj are distinguished polynomials. This is a power series ring. So you can talk of distinguished polynomials there, just as you do in the case of power series ring, analytic power series with complex variables, for instance. So this is a distinguished polynomial, and there's a bunch of those. So pseudo-isomorphism just means the following. Suppose I have two modules, X and Y. X is pseudo-isomorphic to Y means that there is a homomorphism. There's a module homomorphism. R module, R is this ring, lambda G. So there's a lambda G homomorphism between X and Y, such that the kernel and co-kernel are pseudonull. What does pseudonull mean? Means that it has dimension at least 2 less than the dimension of the Iwasawa algebra. So in the special case when G is gamma, that is when we are working with power series ring ZP double bracket 2, if a module has dimension at least 2 less than the ring has dimension 2. And a module has a dimension at least 2 less means the module dimension is 0, which just means it's finite. So in the case of lambda gamma, this just means that kernel and co-kernel are finite. But in general, it means that the kernel and co-kernel are small in comparison to the ring. They have co-dimension 2. Their dimension at least 2 less than the dimension of the ring, the Krull dimension of the Iwasawa algebra. So in fact, classically, even in the case of commutative algebra, you can give a definition for pseudonull, modules being pseudonull, purely in terms of homological algebra. So that definition carries over in a non-commutative setting. So the concept of being pseudonull carries over because, like I said, for non-commutative Iwasawa algebras, you still have the notion of dimension theory. So for something to have dimension at least 2 less than the dimension of the Iwasawa algebra makes sense, and therefore you have the homological definition of pseudonullity, and this carries over to the non-commutative setting as well. So this gives us the following invariants. The first is the rank, which is R coming in the structure theorem. There's a certain uniqueness hypothesis also in this. This the decomposition is unique. So therefore, R is well defined. And then you sum the number of times P occurs. That is, take the power of all the NIs, the power of the prime P. That's called the mu invariant. And then in the special, let's talk about the special case when G is ZP, that it is just gamma. Then these are distinguished polynomials, right? So in this distinguished polynomial, when G is gamma, so you can talk of the degree of that polynomial. So degree of those polynomials times the power, that's called the lambda invariant. So this lambda invariant is defined when G is gamma, but this mu invariant and the rank are defined in general for commutative Iwasawa algebras. So now let's come back to the case when G is equal to gamma. Then Maeser conjectured that this dual Selmer group over the cyclotomic extension, which we know is finitely generated, he conjectured that it's also torsion as a lambda gamma module. And now we know this to be true. This was one of the most important results proved in Iwasawa theory. This was proved towards the end of the last century, sometime late 1990s. And this is a very deep result. It's due to Kato. Now there's one other invariant. So now you can collect, look at the structure theorem. You can, this Fj, you should really think of this Fj when it is a larger dimensional Iwasawa algebra. This is just a generator of a height 1 prime ideal. I told you that all height 1 prime ideals in these regular local rings are principal. So take a generator. This is really coming from a height 1 prime ideal. So take the product of all of these, Pi to the Ni's and Fj to the Mj's. Take the ideal that it generates. So that's called a characteristic ideal. So the characteristic ideal for any module, take M, look at its torsion part, collect all the powers of P and the height 1 prime ideals that come there, take the product of those, that's called the characteristic ideal. And any generator of this characteristic ideal is called a characteristic power series. So it's really a characteristic polynomial because when it is lambda G, when G is gamma, you can even think of it as a polynomial because we can replace the power series by a distinguished polynomial. Okay, so this I already mentioned, I'm repeating it here, elliptic curve with complex multiplication by K, which is an imaginary quadratic extension, and assume that the base field F over which the elliptic curve is defined contains both the quadratic imaginary quadratic extension as well as the p-torsion points, then the Galois group of the trivializing extension is actually commutative. It is two copies, ZP cross ZP. So it's the next simplest case after the cyclotomic extension. This is two copies of ZP and it's commutative. So classically, Iwasawa theory of elliptic curves was studied over F cyclotomic and these kind of abelian extensions coming from elliptic curves with complex multiplication. And it was largely inspired by Iwasawa's seminal work, the study of the class group. So what Iwasawa did was really study this representation. So given any number field F, take the P to the nth power roots of unity, mu p n, and take its inverse limit. So this is Zp of 1. So of course the Galois group of F acts on this p power roots of unity. So you get a Galois representation again, but this time it's a one-dimensional Galois representation. Zp of 1 tensored with Qp. So it just looks like Qp, except there's a Galois action, because this Qp, the underlying module, is really coming from the p power roots of unity on which there is a Galois action. Okay, so this is the setting. You have F equals F of mu p. Then you have F of mu p infinity. This is the cyclotomic Zp extension. And what Iwasawa did in the 60s and 70s was to study how the class group grows as you climb up this tower. The p part of the class group, how does it grow? And so there he had certain conjectures. So that's called the classical Iwasawa's mu equals zero conjecture, that just relates to the study of a mu invariant of a certain module associated to this Iwasawa algebra. Okay, I'll close by saying that whatever we spoke about elliptic curves, we can do it for modular forms. So if you take an elliptic modular form of weight k, cuspidal new form, and for simplicity, let me assume that the coefficients, the Fourier coefficients, are in Q, then we get a two-dimensional vector space, GLVF. VF is a two-dimensional vector space. So in the particular case of weight 2, because we know that it's modular, then we know that it's coming from an elliptic curve. This coincides with the representation that we discussed above, coming from elliptic curves. In the more broader context of modular forms, what is the definition of ordinary? Because now you know, you no longer have an algebraic object to talk about reduced curve and so on. So ordinary just means that P does not divide the Pth Fourier coefficient AP. And supersingular means that P divides AP. And P divides AP, again, you can further subdivide it into two cases. AP equals zero, AP is not equal to zero. All right, there's one other important conjecture called the main conjecture, which is really for the case when the Galois group is abelian, G is abelian. And roughly, we studied the characteristic power series. We defined the characteristic power series for a module, right? So in particular, if you take a torsion module, which we have at hand because Maeser's conjecture and proved by Kato for certain special cases tells us that the dual Selmer group is actually torsion. So you have a torsion module over the Iwasawa algebra. So you have the characteristic power series of that Selmer group, dual Selmer group. And the main conjecture says there is a periodic L function, which you again view as an object in the Iwasawa algebra, and which interpolates the values of the complex L function. And the main conjecture predicts that the ideal generated by this periodic L function coincides with the characteristic ideal of the dual Selmer group. Okay, and the settings in which this has been extensively studied is when this extension is the cyclotomic Zp extension, or when you take a CM elliptic curve and take the trivializing extension where you get two copies of Zp. All right, so I'll stop here. In the next class, I'll tell you, we'll start with the main conjecture and we'll study how it is related. Why is it interesting? Because it can be related to the Birch and Swinnerton and Dyer conjecture through Iwasawa theory. So I'll talk about that and then we'll go on to explain some of the results known, some of the natural questions one may ask, and what is known about those natural questions, what are the questions that are still open, and so on.